Okay, professor, I read about you, like your political shift, your political thought shift because of your mother. So what was the region and background?
Well, see, I come from a very small village called Papayapet in Warangal district, which is a very, very rural forest zone kind of a situation. My family was a sheep rearing family, shepherds, for generations. So in shepherd families, what happens is the men most of the time are around the sheep, sometimes sheeping in the forest areas along with the sheep and occasionally coming home. And it is the women who really run the family. So my mother was my grandmother was doing that before my father's marriage. And then after their marriage, my mother took over. And gradually she became the caste head also. Though formally my father was the head, but actual running was being done by my mother. Negotiating with revenue officials, forest officials, police. My family was a shepherd group head, which consists of about 20 families or so. So my mother was doing that. And she was trying to really defend the community people, their sheep economy, their... So sometimes clashes will occur with police patrols of the village, or with the forest officials, or with the local landlords. My mother was the leader. So right from my childhood, I saw her as a kind of heroine. She used to dress with a folded sari and then walk miles and miles, and then several times she will negotiate in favor of the shepherd communities. So that impression of my mother, and then later on, you know, in my family there was no education history, and it was she when the first village teacher after the freedom in 1960, one village teacher was appointed there. So he came and asked her, send your sons to school. So in the beginning she said, no, we shepherds, we kurmas can't send our children to school. We think that education is not meant for us. You know, this goddess Saraswati gives education to Brahmins and Banyas. If our children go to school, she might kill them. So Shudras don't go to school. But he somehow persuaded her. She spoke to one or two of my relatives and she finally admitted her in the school. It was a single teacher school, and then so I had to study up to class 5th in my village. From there onwards I have to go to a bigger village for class 6th, and that was a village of landlord. So she had to take us, both me and my brother, and literally put at the feet of a landlord, begging him for seats in the school. So he pitied her and then gave a slip that admit your children there. So she was facing all problems. Education was not supposed to be our family thing. We were supposed to look after sheep, goat and cattle. We had some and so on. But she was also for defending these family resources, the caste resources, as vis-a-vis the most unscrupulous village police patrol. And several times she was attacked by them. And in one of the attacks, she had a very bad injury when I was in class 9th. And in order to overcome the pain from those blows she received, she took an injection from a quack And that got, it was, it became a septic. So he developed tetanus and died when I was in class 9th. So my memory of our struggles or bravery or arguments with people, left an imprint in my mind. My father was not a very intelligent man. He used to look after sheep or some agricultural work, drink toddy, the palm tree liquid that villages produce. He also taught me how to drink that. So that's how my mother is my... So my autobiography is coming soon. It's called A Shepherd as an Intellectual. So there are two chapters around her life. She's a phenomenal woman who worked around sheep economy and community and growth and development and introducing us to education.
And what was the reaction from the community member at that time?
Well, one of the main problems of her when she was dying, on the deathbed, she became suddenly unconscious, but still she held our hands. Both of us were at that time at home. Said, "My sons, I may die without getting you married." Imagine we are in 9th class and we were supposed to have got married by then. And our relatives by that age got married. So both me and my elder brother, my two younger sisters, younger to me, got married just before 3 years. So when they were only 12 or so. So the community was saying, "Why are you putting these kids in the schools where they are cooking and eating and studying, what does this study for? They should have got married by now and the family sheep economy would have been made slightly better." So she was struggling to negotiate with the stigma that early marriages could be not done. And of course, he died without fulfilling that desire. Her desire was not to see us as employees or intellectuals or something, but to get some education, to look into the family thing. And that was the time India was in transition. The Shudras, who were illiterate for centuries, were getting into school slowly. And there were taluka village linkages coming, revenue system was slowly transforming and so on. So our wish was that we could become literate negotiators of family life. But she suddenly died and that was our pain. Even my father, when he died later, when I was in BA second year. So one of the great struggles between me and him was that he wanted me to get married. He was also becoming sick because my mother was not there. And so I said, "No, I cannot get married and continue my studies. I don't want to leave a wife here and then." So he was dead against that. So he too died, his desire unfulfilled. So, I mean, even till today, I never fulfilled that desire. By not getting married at all. So the question is that, the historical Shudra community, each caste has a cultural mode of life. But child marriage was a common thing among the Shudras and Dalits, even among the Brahmins and upper caste. So, secondly, once you are married, your wife and child and your sheep and goat, your family struggle. So I thought there should be a liberation at one point. So I then went to my graduation. Then I started reading Karl Marx, Communist Manifesto.
But before that, when you said with a smile, like still that desire doesn't happen regarding marriage, right? Yeah. You must be in love relation, right?
Well,
that's different, no? Having a love relation and getting married.
No, see, in caste conditions of India.
No, this is your own personal life.
Right, but okay. What I'm saying is that love is not an easy thing among our caste. Now, the love in the villages does not take place because love has to be for marriage and you can't go for inter-caste marriage.
No, but you left village, no? For a sister.
Right. Then by the time I was in BA, my father from my pre-university course 1 year, he was dead for marriage, some alliances were coming. By then my brother got married. I said, no, not now. Let me first study further and further. He was, no, this is too much of an unmarried life. So maybe I was around 19 or 20. He was saying that this is beyond marriage age. Villages, nobody can be like this. So in village atmosphere, unmarried situation till then is seen as some sort of a non-potential human existence. That's what many old women were saying, talking to me. I mean, I was not getting married even after my father's death when I was completing my BA degree. So a lot of, even my grandmother, my mother's mother would ask, what is your problem? So near about neighbor Muslim old women would come, this caste, that caste, some you know, amma relations, dada, dadi relations, something like that. So there is something wrong with you. I said, yes, there is something wrong with me. And let me live with my something wrong. See, in village caste cultural thing, India is never...
No, you left village, no? You were
no,
at
but
college.
My interaction with village was consistent, quite weekly, monthly, because I was studying in my district headquarters, up to BA. Then I came to MA,
yeah.
To Usmania University.
Yeah.
Now, the question is, in the caste-cultural relations, one could have even premarital or extramarital relations, but when one cannot go for marriage outside caste. So why these women were doubting me? I was not even doing that. They hear children's stories that this boy is running after that girl, this relationship, that relationship. So there was no such story. I was into my books, my reading. Whenever I go home, I have my book. So one old woman would ask this question also. It's a very healthy trend. This kind of queries will be asked.